Good morning and welcome to United Presbyterian Church's online worship experience, the seventh Sunday of Easter, Ascension Sunday, and Memorial Day weekend. We are so glad that you've chosen to worship with us this morning. Thank you. Now, if you have a candle, go ahead and get it out and light it as a symbol of God's presence with us as we worship. And in terms of announcements this morning, there's a lot going on at the church. Literally, my head's been spinning with all the things that have been going on here and the ways we're reaching out to the community. And if you're not seeing anything that we're doing on our social media, go ahead, www.facebook.com. If you search United Presbyterian Church, Superior, Wisconsin, will come up. Go ahead, like us, follow us there. If you want to receive emails from us, go ahead and shoot an email to unitedpresbyterianchurch@gmail.com, and we'll get you connected in that way. And if you want to send us your address and receive the mail we're sending out, and we are sending out mail, go ahead and just call the church office, and we'll make sure to get connected with you. Well, let's begin our worship this morning with our introit, Spirit of the Living God, hymn number 288. Join with me now. Join with me now in the call to worship adapted from Psalm 43, printed in your online bulletin. Vindicate us, O God, and defend our causes against a people who wish for evil.
For you are the God in whom we take refuge.
O send out your light and truth. Let them lead us.
Let them bring us to your holy hill and to your dwelling.
Then we will go to the altar of God, to God our exceeding joy.
Hope in God, for we shall again praise our God, our help and our God.
Join with me now in our next hymn, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, hymn number 1.
Oh,
Join with me now in the prayer of confession printed in your online bulletin. Let us pray. God, who reached out to us, we confess that it is often scary for us to reach out to those who don't look or act like us. We confess that it is hard to worship you when we cannot physically see you. We confess that sometimes because of this, we end up worshiping things that are material. We confess our discomfort at trusting things unseen. We confess our attachment to material objects. We confess that many of us are tired of worshiping online. Forgive us for our fear. Forgive us for our misplaced worship. Forgive us for our lack of trust in the immaterial. Remind us that you loved us first. Remind us of the power that the Holy Spirit gives us to both reach out to those unlike us and to worship you. As we stay home, continue to renew and refresh both our hearts and our minds. Help us to be patient and safe. Heal us, transform us, make yourself known through us. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, amen. Family, we know that everything from bitterness, rage, and anger can swell up inside us, and it does. But despite this, God asks us to be kind, tender-hearted, and compassionate to one another. Even when we fall short of this reality, God's love carries us. Witness and believe the good news of the gospel. Because of Christ's birth, life, death, and especially Christ's resurrection, we are all forgiven. Amen. I now invite you to pass the peace of Christ with one another down below in the comment section using the words, "The peace of Christ be with you." And feel free to chat amongst yourselves as what's going on in your lives right now down below in the comment section now.
Good morning.
Peace be with you.
Good morning. Time for children. Do you ever lose things? Maybe a pencil that you need at school, or your backpack when you're getting ready to go to school, your shoes, or a hat? Have you ever watched your parents search for something? They're looking all over the house and they can't find their keys and it's time to go. Or maybe a tool that they need to fix something around the house. How frustrating it is to need a certain thing and not be able to find it. Have you ever looked for something, searched high and low for something, and then you found it right where it was supposed to be? I have. It was right in plain sight. In the Bible, the Apostle Paul talks about people searching for God, and people still search for God today. Paul says, "God is not far from each one of us, for in God we live and move and have our being." Paul reminds us that God made the world and all the things in it. We are God's children. And we don't need to search far and wide to find God. We don't need to search in things or in other people or places. The Bible teaches us to be quiet and listen. Pray. God's Spirit lives within us. And when you accept God's love, it's with you always. Let us pray. God, thank you for your love. Please help us to remember that you are near, and all we have to do is reach out to you. Help us find ways to share your love with others who are searching. Amen. This morning, we are recognizing members, family, and friends of United Presbyterian Church who are graduating from high school or college. Please enjoy the video slideshow. Thank you. We come together, not in the way we would want, but in the way we are able. We would rather be sitting in rows of chairs, cheering you on as you cross the stage. We would rather be standing side by side for photos to mark your accomplishment. We would rather be in the same place, telling you face to face how proud we are of you, how excited we are for your future, and how grateful we are to have you in our lives. Someday we will be able to celebrate you in person, but until then, we want you to know we recognize this milestone, all the hard work and energy, all the changes and challenges, all the memories and experiences that have gotten you to this point. You are fearfully and wonderfully made, a unique reflection of God's image. We rejoice that God made you just as you are. We thank God for the gifts we see in you. You persevered through challenges, refusing to give up despite difficult circumstances. We recognize your tenacity and strength. You've accomplished much during your time as a student, learning new skills, trying new things, making new friends, finding new passions. We celebrate you and your many achievements. Your curiosity and creativity are inspiring. We cannot wait to see where your questions lead you. We will be eager to hear about your explorations. You have many people who love and care for you. We support you and we believe in you. We know that you are God's beloved child, surrounded by the Holy Spirit and prayed for by us and by Jesus Christ. You are claimed and named by God. We trust God's promise that if we ask, we will receive. And therefore we ask God to watch over you and bless you. We are people who live in hope at this time of transition when you begin a new phase of your life's journey. We know that the road ahead will not always be smooth or easy or obvious, and nonetheless, we have faith in your ability to navigate whatever lies ahead. We have faith in God's sure presence with you. We have faith in your willingness to ask for help when you need it, accept and extend mercy often, and practice courageous kindness always. When you are afraid or anxious, unsure or struggling, we want you to know that you can call us. Those of us gathered today want you to know how valuable you are to us and to God. You are irreplaceable. While we are all proud of what you have done to reach this goal, we love you for who you are. We ask that God will bless you. And remembering that nothing can separate you from the love of God, let us pray. God of every season, we ask your prayers this day for these graduates as they graduate and look to the future. Remind them of all they have achieved so far. May these memories embolden and strengthen them when they face challenges. Help them to know that they are loved by you and by all of us. Comfort them in their grief at the loss of the rituals of cap and gown, ceremony and speeches, family gatherings and celebrations with friends. Assure them of your presence, your power, your providence, and your grace. Reveal to them a sure sense of purpose and peace, especially when they feel afraid and anxious. May they recognize the gifts you have given, and may those gifts bring them joy, a joy that increases when they are shared with the world. Surround them with the Holy Spirit so that every day they may know that they are loved, beautiful, and blessed to be a blessing. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Congratulations to all of our graduates.
Today's scripture reading is from Psalm 66, verses 8 through 20. Praise our God, O peoples. Let the sound of his praise be heard. He's preserved our lives and kept our feet from slipping. For you, O God, tested us. You refined us like silver. You brought us into prison and laid burdens on our backs. You let men ride over our heads. We went through fire and water, but you brought us to a place of abundance. I will come to your temple with burnt offerings and fulfill my vows to you. The vows my lips promised and my mouth spoke when I was in trouble. I will sacrifice fat animals to you and an offering of rams. I will offer bulls and goats. Come and listen, all you who fear God. Let me tell you what he has done for me. I cried out to him with my mouth. His praise was on my tongue. If I had cherished sin in my heart, the Lord would not have listened, but God has listened and heard my voice in prayer. Praise be to God, who has not rejected my prayer or withheld his love from me.
This week, I've had meetings upon meetings upon meetings through technology like Zoom. I even had a socially distanced walkthrough survey of this sanctuary as we wondered what technology we needed to implement to bring live streaming capabilities to our services, even once this COVID-19 pandemic is over. And I should let you know, Session approved those plans, and plans are now in the work to not only enhance these services like this, but to implement live streaming from here on out. The worship committee and Session have begun the important and significant process of working together to develop plans of safety and yet adventure, utilizing technology for this new season that we're entering into concerning when and how the church can safely gather together again. And I should let you know that this coming week, you will be receiving a letter from your Session and myself detailing some plans that we're going to have in place and ideas that we have in place as we start navigating coming back to what services could look like in the future. Your fellowship committee got creative with plans for a socially distanced drive-through barbecue to celebrate the 6.5 years that Christy Wilmore has served as our Director of Children, Youth, and Family Ministries, and to also celebrate the oncoming of Laura Foote as the interim Children, Youth, and Families Director. We surveyed a location and began the work of partnering with our community and our congregation to help our neighbors repair their homes. We surveyed that this week. And even then, we added another office to the church for our treasurer, Christy Wilmore, as she changed it. And now that new office is in the library, and we've moved the library to an even more accessible place for all to access it when people can come back into the building. We have been busy at work, UPC. We've been changing things and moving things around and doing really, really, really good work. On top of that, your leadership has been immersing themselves in the worlds of health and technology, not only this week, but over the past few weeks, because we desire as a church to live empowered as the Holy Spirit would have us, to reach out to our neighbors, to care for our community, to witness to the work and life of Jesus Christ in our lives, in our community's lives, in our church's lives, and in the life of the world. God is at work now, and God will continue to be at work, and no pandemic will stop that. And I hope you can tell from the slight busyness that's been happening at church that God is at work. Now, last week, I told you all that we'd be discussing the event when the Holy Spirit came to the earth and first entered into people's lives, known as Pentecost. But we're not going to do that this week. We're actually going to do that next week. So wear your red next week. Instead, I want us to back up and discuss a little bit more of what we talked about last week. What it means to be empowered by the Holy Spirit. What it means to live empowered by the Holy Spirit. And I believe Paul gives us a good clue as to what that is like in his sermon to the people in the ancient city of Athens, Greece. Right? I believe we can learn two things from Paul's interactions here. First, what it looks like, what it means to be empowered by the Holy Spirit to reach out to people that are unlike you. And two, and this is more of the focus of the sermon this Sunday, who and what We are called to worship in our lives and the role that faith in God is supposed to take in our lives. Our New Testament reading this morning comes from the book of Acts, chapter 17, verses 22 through 31. Listen closely for the word of God. Then Paul stood in front of the Areopagus and said, "Athenians, I see how extremely religious you are in every way. For as I went through the city and looked carefully at the objects of your worship, I found among them an altar with the inscription, 'To an unknown God.' What therefore you worship is unknown. This I proclaim to you, the God who made the world and everything in it, yes, even the very idols you carved out of stone, he who is Lord of heaven and earth does not live in shrines made by human hands, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mortals life and breath and all things. From one ancestor he made all the nations to inhabit the whole earth, and he allotted the times of their existence and the boundaries of the places where they would live, so that they would search for God and perhaps grope for him and find that God. Though indeed God is not far from each one of us. For in God we live and move and have our being, as even some of your own poets have said. For we too are God's offspring. Since we are God's offspring, we ought not to think that the deity is like gold or silver or stone or even wood, an image formed by the art and imagination of mortals. No. While God has overlooked the times of human ignorance, now God commands all people everywhere to repent, because God has fixed a day on which God will have the world judged in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. And of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. You have heard the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. God, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be worthy and acceptable to you. And may we glorify you, God, in their carrying out. For you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. The book of Acts is the story of the very first church. I've told you that many times, but chapter 17, where we pick up the story, has Paul, the very same man who authorized the murder of Stephen the Apostle that we talked about. It was gruesome, by stoning, that we discussed a few weeks ago, living a changed life, going out to visit the many cities in the Mediterranean that early Christians had settled in or returned to. He did this to check in on how they were doing at planting house churches, starting communities in their own cities, going out from that first community in Jerusalem. Now, due to their route, Paul ends up in the city of Athens, Greece, for a short time. He hadn't planned on going there, but he ends up there because they need to make a stop. There are basically no Christians in this city. Like I said, it's kind of a wayside stop. And it's important to recognize that the church at this point is so small, so insignificant in the world, that there really aren't any Christians there. There's no influence of Christianity on this town of Athens. In fact, many people see Christianity as this weird offshoot religion, if they've even heard of it, kind of like a little cult that has started following around this man named Jesus. So it's no surprise that there really are no Christians in Athens besides Paul and those who are traveling with him. In fact, not only aren't there many Christians, there really are no Jews present there either, because Athens was a hub for Greek religious worship and Greek philosophical teachings. This was kind of the educational mainstay. This is where it all came out from. And so Paul decides, because, you know, there are no Christians, there are no Jews, there aren't anyone that knows the philosophy that he's going to talk about. Paul decides, therefore, to preach a short sermon to the Athenian people. And that is what we have before us in this text, Paul's sermon to these people that probably have never heard of Jesus. Now, before we get into this text, I want us to recognize this powerful move in Paul's life. You might not know a lot about him, but Paul was a Jew, formerly named Saul. He was a Pharisee, someone who found Christians and killed them. Not every Pharisee was like that, but Paul, or Saul, was a special breed that went out and found Christians, hunted them down, and killed them. Like Stephen. Like Stephen that we talked about weeks ago. Now, Paul, because of a moment where the Holy Spirit entered into his life, is planting churches, Christian churches, and making sure that they grow, that they grow up and flourish. He's tending to them. And he's doing this not just to anyone. He's not reaching out to just anyone, but he's reaching out to Gentiles, people who are not ethnically Jewish, to the people of the Jewish faith. Intermingling with Gentiles was unheard of. It was a drastic step, something you would never want to do. Even for some people who converted from Judaism to Christianity, like Paul himself did, it was a huge problem to interact with Gentiles. You didn't want to work with them, people who were not ethnically Jewish. And that in and of itself is what the empowerment of the Holy Spirit does. It changes your life. This is point number one. What does the empowerment of the Holy Spirit look like? It looks like moving from being a religious leader in the Jewish faith, trained, as scholars point out, to loathe the religious practices of Gentiles, of other people, who persecutes Christians, who kills them, to becoming a Christian who wants to work, worship, and live alongside those he was trained to detest. That's the changing power of the Holy Spirit. And that's point number one. It causes you to reach out to people you would have never reached out to. It causes you to love people you would have never loved. And so we pick up our story for point number two at the beginning of Paul's sermon. Paul's sermon is a soft polemic against idolatry. Right? But more importantly, it's a sermon about how God loves even people who don't worship God. The city of Athens, being a center for Greek philosophy and predominantly, if not exclusively, Gentile, like I mentioned before, not Jewish, not Christian, but Gentile, had many, many idols strewn about. And if you don't know what an idol was or an idol is, In this context, it's a little statue or a shrine made so that you can worship it. It's an image of a deity, a small g god that you might believe in those days. It was a shrine or a statue made for worship of anyone besides the God of the Torah, the God of the Bible, right? So this city is filled with all these shrines and statues made out of stone and wood and precious metals like gold and silver, all to other gods besides the God of the Bible. And as he is perusing the city, Paul even identifies an idol with an inscription on it that reads, "To an unknown God." And I imagine Paul chuckles to himself, wow, these Athenians really must be trying to cover their bases with all these gods made out of all these materials. They don't even know them, but they're making them. And he begins his sermon and says, "Look, Athenians, I get it. Y'all are extremely religious. Some of the most religious people I've ever met. There are idols everywhere. I even see one that says, 'To an unknown God.' You got it covered. You got it down. But you should know, the real God of heaven isn't contained in shrines or statues made by human hands. This unknown God, it's not who we're talking about. You see, you understand, the real God created these things that you formed the statues out of. You know, Athenians, that there is a God out there. You're just missing the mark on who that God is. You're worshiping the created rather than the Creator. You got images, but you don't have the full picture. That's the gist of the sermon. You have images, but you don't have the full picture. And I love the way Willie Jennings identifies these idols that are in Athens, and really, truly, all idols in general. He calls them a distorted hope. It's like having a puzzle piece, one or two puzzle pieces connected, and thinking that we see the entire picture. Because we don't. We don't. We have a few puzzle pieces. And that's because the Athenians are worshiping the created rather than the Creator. The Creator gives us a picture, but not the full picture. It points to the Creator, but it's not the Creator, right? God created trees, and we might be able to carve out a statue or a little thing out of that, or make a beautiful piece of art, and we can say, wow, that is so beautiful. How intricate was that made? But that statue's not God. That piece of wood isn't God. But the intricacy, the beauty, it points to something else. And it gives us real hope. But we won't be able to capture it unless we see that full picture, unless we encounter that full picture. And Paul's sermon is radical, right? It's radical because it's pushing the Athenians to try to reach beyond themselves, to grope beyond themselves, to figure out who this God is. And I wondered if Paul was also reaching out to us, was preaching to us here in the Twin Ports, as if we needed to reach out and go beyond ourselves, go beyond the created. And it got me thinking about the idols in my own life to my unknown, or in my case, pretty much known gods, right? I believe most of us here on this earth don't, as Christians, don't explicitly worship idols in our basement. It's not like we have secretly some, you know, stone statue sitting in the basement that we go down to every night and worship, right? But I think we do have idols in our lives as humans, not explicitly, but implicitly. And so for me, and I'll call myself out here, worshiping idols implicitly has looked like several different things in my life. First, it's looked like my relationship with my wife, Laura, right? I've put her above God. Laura is who I think about the most out of anything. I talk about, think about most above anything, not God. Her relationship has come first in my life. When I order something online, and I suspect most of us have during the Rona, right? You know, we've all been there. We've been online. When I order something online, I want to make sure I order some nice things. I want to make sure that they're eco-conscious. I want to make sure they're ethically made. I want to make sure that they last 20 years. And I want to make sure everyone's paid fair wages and all that's taken care of. And then once I've ordered that item, and I see the shipping notification, I'll check that shipping notification and that tracking over and over and over throughout a day. Even though there's an expected date of delivery, you know, 5 days down the road, I'm going to check that 8 times because I want that feeling that item's going to give me. I want that item, this created piece of material. In my life, I want to like certain brands because of the image they give off. Whether it be Apple or another brand, I want it because it's quality and because I know that it's going to last a long time, right? And so I'll research those things ad nauseum over and over and over. And whether it be Instagram and checking in on how people are doing or what someone's doing in their lives, or the outdoors, because if you've talked to me in the last 2 weeks, I've definitely told you about Split Rock Falls and Iona's Beach and how much I love to be out there, right? I've talked about the outdoors, and all of these things. My phone, it's Apple, it's great. I got an iPhone. My email, I wonder when someone's going to get back to me. All of these things. All of these things at some point, whether it be my relationship or the outdoors or something else, at some point garners my attention or my love before God does. All of them do. If I'm being honest, at some point in my life they do. And that's when they become idols. That's when they become idols. And I know, though, that when God does come first, these things all can and do point back to God, right? I love my wife, Laura, well because I love God. And God's love teaches me to love Laura well. I want to purchase something that's ethically made because my faith in God directs me to do that, to care for the planet, to care for my neighbor, to support the local economy, right? I want to be outdoors and take care of the earth and celebrate places like Pattison Park or Amnicon Falls or Split Rock or whatever it is. Not because I worship the earth, not because I love the earth, but because I love God and my relationship with God points me to take care of the earth and to celebrate the earth and to love the earth I've been given well. Do you understand that difference? It's subtle, but it's important. So here, UPC, is what I want you to do this week. There's a tangible thing I want you to do, and I know how you know that I love lists. And so I am going to ask you to make, again, a list this week, but I want you to make a realistic list. And that's the key word. I want you to make a realistic list, an honest list of the top five things you love and care about most in your life, whether it be family, your car, maybe it's your faith. Maybe it's a certain clothing brand that you love. Maybe it's fishing. Whatever it is, I want you to write down 1 through 5 in your notes app, or Microsoft Word, or on a piece of paper. I'm not going to make you post this up anywhere or do anything with it. But I want you to go ahead and reflect on those 1 through 5, right? And I want you to ask yourself this question. What are your idols? Right? What are your idols? Now I want you to rewrite that list. And I want you to put faith in God or God as number one, right? And I want you to write down one action step that you can take next to that list that would make that a reality in your life. Your faith in God is the number one thing. Because living empowered by the Holy Spirit, what Paul's trying to communicate to these people that God loves, and God loves us, and we are empowered by the Holy Spirit. So what Paul's trying to communicate to us is that because that when you live empowered by the Holy Spirit, God becomes the number one thing in your life. And all of your love, all of your care, all of your attention flows out of that relationship with God. You love your family well because God loves you. You care for the earth because God loves you. You care for your spouse because God loves you. You buy clothes that are going to last a long time and not fast fashion that ends up in a landfill in 2 weeks because of your faith in God. Everything flows out of that faith. Those items, your family, your relationship with your spouse, the earth, your iPhone, whatever it is, created, material, is an image that points us back to the Creator. And that Creator wants us to care for those things, steward those things, love those things out of our love for the Creator. Empowered by the Holy Spirit, we can do that. Amen. I'll now invite you to join with us in our next hymn.
Victorious.
Into the part of our service where we take this morning's tithe and offering. But before we do that, I'd like to share a little bit with you about what's been going on in the life of the church, what's been going on in the life of United, and how we've been reaching out. We actually have another Hot Dish Initiative coming up this next Sunday, May 31st, between 4:30 and 5:30. And if you're not familiar with the Hot Dish Initiative, a team of folks protected and protective equipment, go ahead and prepare many, many meals for entire families, from the meal to the dessert, freezes them ahead of time and distributes them to the community as anyone has need. No questions asked. Last time, they ran out of meals within an hour of it coming out. So we've decided to make more meals this time. So if you know anyone that has a need for food, and we know that food insecurity is very real now during COVID here in the Twin Ports, go ahead and contact the church. We'll make sure that you get a meal. Just give us a shout or show up between 4:30 and 5:30 next Sunday, May 31st. And so now I'll invite you all to give this morning's tithe and offering. And if you'd like to give to the Hot Dish Initiative or just to the general workings of the church, and we are doing a lot right now, you can go ahead and give our tithe at the link below in the description. You can send in and mail in your donation to the church. We're checking the mailbox daily. Or you can come between 12 and 4, Monday through Friday, to the church office, and we'll be happy to take your tithe or donation that way. I now invite you to give this morning's tithe and offering.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures high and low. Hallelujah.
Join with me now in the prayer over the offering. Let us bless these gifts. God, who asks us to get rid of idols in our lives, we offer all our gifts to you, our lives, our passions, and so much more. Bless these tithes and offerings. Bless our mission and vision as the church as we reach out with our neighbors for the betterment of our community. May we be good stewards of these gifts, and may we be generous neighbors. Help us to connect with and care for our community so that the Twin Ports may know that they are loved by us and by God. In the name of the Holy Trinity, amen. We'll now move into the part of our service where we share in prayer together. And so some of the prayers in the community's hearts and minds right now is we want to lift up Barb and Daryl Granquist. Daryl's been going through a number of medical realities that haven't been so great, even had a trip to the hospital. And so we want to lift up Daryl as he recovers at home, and he is recovering, and we want to lift up Barb as she cares for him and nurses him back to health a little bit. We also want to pray this Memorial Day weekend for all those families who have lost loved ones in armed conflict. We know that You mourn, but you do not mourn as those without hope. You mourn together, together with God and together with us. And so we lift up all those families now. We also want to lift up all those healthcare professionals that are on the front lines doing some serious work, both here in our church community, and there are a number, as well as those in the Twin Ports and all around the nation and world as they fight something that they've never seen in their lifetimes. So God, we're asking for them to have protection and care. We want to lift up all those folks that are scared right now, as well as they navigate states opening up and what that means and if there's going to be a spike or not and all the anxiety that comes with this pandemic. All of the anxiety that is induced by seeing another person. And we want to lift up all those people that are afraid right now too. And so now I'd invite us all to move into a time of silent prayer where we lift up those folks who haven't been mentioned out loud, but who are on our hearts now. God, we come before you and lift up all of those folks here in this community, here in our community that are experiencing different health realities. Especially now in the midst of COVID, we pray that they can get the care that they need and deserve and should have. We pray that you give doctors wisdom as they treat, nurses as well as they care for and treat. We ask that you work, you God would work in the bodies of all those that are facing these uncertain medical realities. God, we pray in this community for all those whom their relationship is tense right now. Maybe their relationship is even broken. God, we ask that you would heal individuals. You would heal their hearts, that you would create healthy systems for them to be a part of. And God, we just lift up every single relationship, not here, just here in this church, but here in our communities and here in this country and world, as we think about all the time that people are spending together, all the time that people are stuck together. God, we just pray that your Holy Spirit would work in such a way that it would heal relationships. And we think of all those people that are experiencing any sort of abuse or things like that, God, that you would find them and that you would find them safety, that you would get them safety, God. You would help put people in their lives that would help them get out of those situations. God, we pray for the day when abuse is no more, and we pray against any abuse that is taking place. God, as we look out at a nation that's reeling, we think of business owners, we think of those who have lost loved ones to this pandemic. Think of all those who are grieving, whether it be normalcy, whether it be life, whether it be livelihood. God, these are painful times. Painful times all around. But help us to grieve, God. Help us to grieve in such a way, not as those without hope, but those who can hope in your Son, Jesus. As we look out into this world, God, we ask, how long? How long will we have to endure? So God, we ask that you would intervene, that you would help create a vaccine for this coronavirus, that you would speed up that process, God, in miraculous ways even, so that all people could be safe, that we could trust scientists to help us get back on our way, God, of loving and serving you. Remind us of your presence when we're lonely. Remind us of your presence as we grieve and as we're sad. And God, we thank you that the seasons are changing, that we're seeing new buds and new life even while all this is going on. We thank you for that new life. And God, when we come to an end of our words, your son Jesus' words ring true when he taught the disciples to pray by saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us of our debts as we forgive our indebtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen." Join with me now in our closing hymn, "Let Us Build a House," hymn number 301. Let us sing.
Treasure taught and claimed as words within the word.
Now receive the blessing and benediction. May the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit go with you now. And as you stay home in peace. And return no one evil for evil, but love and serve God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, always worshiping God and not idols, now and forevermore. Amen. I now invite you to actually go to the Zoom link below. You'll see it. We're going to have a Zoom coffee hour at 11:10 Central Time below here now.